to see you. Holy, 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 holy,
I want to see.
Holy, 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 I want to see.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He has done great things. See what our Savior has done. See how His love overcomes. You have done great things. He has done great things. And break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You'll be faithful through every storm. You'll be faithful forevermore. You have done great things. And I know you will do it again. For your promise is yes and amen. You have done great things. God, you do great things. Break every chain, oh God. You have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things.
Sing hallelujah.
Above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Hallelujah, God, above it all, hallelujah, God, unshakable, hallelujah, you have done great things. Oh hero, hero of heaven, you conquer the grave, you free every captive and break every chain, oh God, you have done great things. We dance in your freedom, awake and alive. Oh Jesus, our Savior, your name lifted high, oh God. You have done great things. You have done great things. Oh God, you do great things.
Everyone, and welcome once again to our church here on Zoom. And I trust that you've all had a wonderful week and been challenged and perhaps tested. And it has been an opportunity for you to face your particular challenges this week with trust or with fear. And we all have that challenge and choice every day as we wake up and look at what each day comes and what comes our way. And if we choose to trust and wait, as we've been looking and examining our way through the life of Moses and the Hebrew people through Exodus, that God brings those certain things along our paths to test us and to see if we will be faithful in the sense of really saying, God, I don't know what's going on, but you do, so I can sit back and trust you. So welcome. And I trust that you'll be encouraged this morning as we gather together as well. I'm going to take a bit of a different approach this morning. As you are aware, we switched things around a little bit and coming on Zoom this week rather than a pre-recorded time. In fact, for the next little while, we're going to be, well, for the next this week and next week, we're going to be staying on this Zoom platform. I think it's great to be able to stay live. The last couple of weeks that I, as we'll be pastoring and on with you, and then before we go into the summer months. And so I just want to bring that to your attention so that you can be aware of that as well. I've been asked a couple of questions from various people saying, hey, what's going on with your family? Obviously difficult over the last year and a half to see, you know, and touch base with people that we love in our church family and beyond. And what there's things, a lot of things happen in a year and a half. And so I've asked my family to answer a few questions via video about what things are going on in their life. So I would like to share those with you this morning a little bit, if I could take that opportunity and that liberty to do that. And you can hear from us as the Bergman family of what is going on for us. So that would be great. Meanwhile, obviously this will be recorded as well. And you can catch those later on in our YouTube channel too. But before we begin, I want to read to you from Exodus 19. And this is the encounter that the Hebrew people have with God, where God has brought them out of Egypt. And we've just sung a song called Great Things that God has done for us. And it's a continued primer and reminder of what God is doing in our lives, that he has done great things. And of course, for the people of Israel, the Hebrew people, as they meandered their way through the wilderness after the plagues, after the Red Sea, after the incredible gifting that God gave and provision for them with manna in the mornings and quail as a protein meat for them. And then he brings them to this place at the base of this incredible mountain. And we recognize it as Mount Sinai. This grandeur mountain. In fact, I did a couple of Google searches to find some pictures of Mount Sinai just to get an idea of its grandeur and its height, etc. My understanding is that this mountain is over 8,000 feet high, and it's where God encountered his people in the wilderness. And there's a reason and a purpose for that. And so I want to open it just with that. We're going to read just the first 8 verses here. And then I want to go into some of those videos that I share about my family. And we're going to come back and to have some primer through worship and also some other, the rest of the chapter. So if you've got your Bibles and you'd like to join in the reading, in fact, I'd love to have a little bit of some participation in that way. If you've got your Bibles and you'd be willing to read a portion of the scripture, that would be great. I don't see a lot of videos out there, so I can't see if hands are up there, but I do see Cam. Cam, would you be willing to read one of those? Okay, I'm going to assign them right now then while you're sitting here. Cam, if you could read Exodus 19, we're in chapter 19, and look at verses 9 to 13, that would be great. So verses 9 to 13. Jerry, would you have your Bible ready? Would you be willing to read? Yes, that's a thumbs up. Or a stop, I don't want to do it. Okay, thumbs up. Jerry, if you've got your Bible there, Exodus 19, and if you could read verses 16 to 20. You do that? Okay, verses 16 to 20. So I'll let you know when the time comes for that to be read. That would be wonderful. Meanwhile, let me read to you, and I'll share the screen for the first eight verses here of our time together. Let me just share a screen. This is from chapter 19. And again, it says, exactly 2 months after the Israelites left Egypt, they arrived in the wilderness of Sinai. And after breaking camp at Rephidim, they came to the wilderness of Sinai and set up camp there at the base of Mount Sinai. Then Moses climbed the mountain to appear before God. I find that amazing because here's Moses in his he's post 80 now, and he's climbing this mountain that is 8,000 something feet high. And the Lord called him from the mountain and said, give these instructions to the family of Jacob. Announce it to the descendants of Israel. You have seen what I did to the Egyptians. You know, again, the great things, how I carried you on eagle's wings and I brought you to myself. I love that imagery that the Lord gives there around this eagle's wings, the safety, security, the flight, etc. Now, if you will obey me and keep my covenant, you will be my own special treasure from among all the peoples on earth, for all the earth belongs to me. And you will be my kingdom of priests, my holy nations. And so God is giving them a vision of what he has for them and getting them ready to receive the message in Revelation. This is the message you must give to the people of Israel. And so that was what Moses was given a mandate to do. So Moses returned from the mountain and he called together the elders of the people and he told them everything that the Lord had commanded. And so I just want to continue to read. I don't have it up there, but I wanted to finish into verse 8. And this says, and all the people responded. So Moses returned from the mountain. And he called together all these elders of the people, right? And he tells them this, the words of the Lord, that I want to do this, if you obey me, etc. And all the people responded together. And there's 2 million of them. And they all responded together. We will do everything that the Lord has commanded. And so Moses brought the people back, brought the answer back to the Lord. And so we have here this gathering at the base of the mountain, and Moses standing before the people, probably up a little bit up in the side of the hill, and he's given the message of what God is saying to them, and he's actually preparing them. God has brought them to this point, he's preparing them. And I want to dig into this a little bit deeper in a little bit. And so I want to prime the pump a little bit. We're going to read through all of the verses or majority of the verses here as we go through our time together this morning. But I want to bring to you just a few announcements. Let's just take a quick hiatus from that and some important announcements to share with you in regards to our coming weeks and months to ahead. And so just to mark your calendar for the summer, for 2 weeks in July and 2 weeks in August, we'll be meeting as a church in the Memorial Park in Esquimalt. Your elders team has been working hard to prepare not only for the summer, but into the fall. And there's some good things, believe me, there's some good things. God has been really orchestrating various interactions with people around the future, and it's a good future. So just so you know, mark this off, July 11th, 25, and August 8th and 22 for those particular Sundays. Indeed, as well, coming up really soon in 2 weeks, June 27th, that Sunday morning, mark the time, 11 a.m. at Shea Bergman, our house on 2946 Eileen Terrace. We have planned and we're getting ourselves ready for a potluck together, bring something for the barbecue and something for your family and others to share. We have a plan as far as social distancing. So if those who are are very conscientious about that, please, by all means, don't let that hold you back for our potluck barbecue. And maybe those who are abroad, come on out. Doesn't matter if you're from Ontario or from whatever corner, you're welcome to join us. We have to cap it at 50. So we've asked you to RSVP on an email there to Bill Standeven, just so we get an idea of numbers. But without further avail, I want you to hear from, first of all, from Megan, my wife, in regards to some of the thoughts that she has and what we're doing going forward. So please enjoy.
Hi, it's Megan. And it seems like it's been a long, really, really long time since we've been together, and I really miss that. Recently, I was in the break room at work and having a discussion with one of the surgeons who was eating his supper at the time. And when I left the break room, I remember actually thanking him for his smile. But it didn't dawn on me until later that night when I realized the reason I felt so connected to him in that moment was because he didn't have his mask on while he was eating his meal and we were apart. But I felt connected because I could see his smile, I could see the expression on his face as he told his story, and I felt connected. And in that moment, I realized I really am missing that sense of being connected and seeing people's faces and expressions, and I really value that. I wanted to take a few moments just to update you a little bit on what's been happening in my life and also in the life of my family. It's been a busy last couple of months. I have been at work a lot. Even though I work part-time, I end up working full-time plus because I try to help fill in the gaps. I did take on an opportunity to spend a couple of shifts in the eye clinic at the Royal Jubilee Hospital. But ultimately have found that the heart has pulled me back. I have been in cardiac medicine for over 20 years, and I really value the work that we do in the cardiovascular unit with post-open heart surgery recovery with those family and patients. And I work with a fabulous team. So I work a lot, but I really do enjoy what I do, and I value the work that we do. Outside of work, it has been a busy year for us as a family. Bronwyn, of course, is graduating this year, and between finding a dress, having her hair done, doing a photo shoot, and looking for flowers, it's been a busy time. I think as a family, though, we have managed, even with the restrictions, to find a new and meaningful way to celebrate this milestone for her. And it's been wonderful to see her launch off to her time at Cape and Ray, and the new friends and the forward focus that she has on her future. Of course, Caleb, keeping him alive and fed consumes a lot of my time as well. We always appreciate the challenge and just the thoughtfulness of what he brings home for us to consider and talk about, the things that he finds himself engaged in. Many days have gone by when I hear a rumble downstairs because he's got some sort of SpaceX launch sequence going on with his big speakers in the room above me. Such a joy. And of course, Adele is such a delight. I really enjoy my time chatting with her, reading together, snuggling. We even got involved in MasterChef Canada this year and really enjoyed watching the outcome of that. She's recently taken up the challenge of trying to get me in shape and would like for me to do the 7-minute workout each evening. I have a whole schedule set out for June, but I think I'm 5 days behind. So tonight I'll probably instead, but I do appreciate her time. And of course, Paul and I, we love gardening together. We've recently been doing some renovations on a couple rental properties, so I've been involved in painting, but just trying to eke out those moments together too. A couple weeks ago, I had the privilege to attend the Cape and Ray Ladies Retreat online. They had two weekends back to back. The first was on prayer, and then the second one was on the Book of Ruth, a story of redemption. And I really valued the opportunity to set aside some time and revisit some of those scriptures anew and in a fresh way. One of the things that stood out for me during the weekend on prayer was the speaker really challenging us to question, what is our attitude in prayer? Do we come and are we distracted or hurried, or we have a list of lots of needs or requests? And she actually said, in taking time to be alone with God, we genuinely are seeking Him, and therein is an overflow from being in that inner room and speaking to the Lord. And I've been challenged to see that intentionally in my own life. Alongside of that, I've also, starting June 1st, been a part of something called the Same Page Summer Bible Reading Challenge, where we read through the New Testament in June, July, and August. Each day there's a set out calendar for which scriptures to read. I did this last summer, and I found it super valuable just to see the connectivity of scripture when you read it thoroughly like that. This past week, one of the things that stood out to me in there was 1 John 5:21, which says, "Dear children, keep away from anything that might take God's place in your hearts." That's the challenge for myself and a prayer for you as well. Blessings in this day. Thanks for just taking the time.
Everybody, was everybody able to see that okay? Hopefully that was all right. I asked Bronwyn, who is on Cape and Ray right now, as a staff person, just to give us a bit of an update, and just also an opportunity, just to an FYI for you, next weekend it is Father's Day, and it is also our grads and dads celebration. And so we got two wonderful grads this year, Sarah Terleski, and also Bronwyn, my daughter. And these girls are two incredible young ladies, and I'm going to be having them share via video next week, some of their stuff that they're doing. So I want you to make note of that, and we'll celebrate them well as fathers. You guys, as fathers, we have a special tribute to you as well. I'm going to share my screen again and let you hear just from Bronwyn and then my two other kids. There's short little videos here that they have put together. Please, thank you. We're going to do that right now.
Okay, hi everyone, it's Bronwyn. I'm here on Thetis Island at Cape and Ray Harbour. I just thought I'd share a quick life update for you guys. This last year I just graduated from Oak Bay High in Victoria, and I will be staying on working as a lifeguard here at Cape and Ray for the summer, and then continuing on for the next year here, doing a year of Bible school, where I'm excited to learn about living through Christ. And one of my favorite memories of Harbourview was in the basement of the Esquimalt United Church when we first moved in. There was those big poles. I don't know if any of you remember the poles that went from floor to ceiling, and Caleb and I would climb those things barefoot like a bunch of monkeys, and my poor mother would get mad at us. But that was one of my highlights of Harbourview. And one of the other ones was my dad on Easter Sunday for our sunrise service. His famous line was, "Jesus rose from the dead, you can get out of bed." And I'm sure many of you have heard that, but it's what he's held on to these last couple years. So, yeah, and one of the verses that's been sticking out to me recently is Philippians 1, verse 29. "For to you it has been granted for Christ's sake, not only to believe in him, but also to suffer for his sake, experiencing the same conflict which you saw in me and now here to be in me." So that's just been a good reminder that in life you're not going through it by yourself. You have people around you, and you have Jesus by your side at all times. So I hope to see you all soon. It's been great these last couple years, and yeah, thank you. Love you all.
Hi, I'm Caleb. I'm finishing grade 10 this year. I've had some pretty intense quarters in school, but it's been pretty good. Next year I'm taking TIAC 105, which is an engineering course with Camosun College. During this year I've been able to play some volleyball with our team, and I've also done some mountain biking. I've bought a bike, and I've been riding and fixing that up. This summer, I'm volunteering at Cape and Ray with my cousin Hedock. Cape and Ray is also where Bronwyn is. In August, I'll be fishing with my dad, and I'll be at my grandparents' cabin. A special memory with the church would be always getting up in the morning, on Sunday morning, and going to Tim Hortons.
You caught that, but... Both my children's memories have nothing to do with my teaching or deep, deep truths. It's about climbing poles and hitting Tim Hortons as we head to church in the morning. So that's it's precious. I got one more to share with you, and that's my youngest, and she is my little monkey. And so I just want to share with you that, and then we'll continue on with our time together in worship.
Welcome. Come and make yourself comfortable. This is my HQ. My dad built this for me about a year ago. It is a fun space, and I've enjoyed decorating with many succulents and lights. I'm just finishing grade 7 this year, and I have loved my teacher and my classroom so very much. My teacher is amazing and gives us so many snacks and treats, and she always lets us go outside. Another thing that I've really enjoyed this year is woodworking. My teacher, Mr. DeLeo, has helped me a lot, and I've made this foldable stool that is really easy to port, and I've also made this turtle ball that swivels open and you can store your jewelry and stuff inside. I am really fortunate to be on the softball team and basketball team this year. Due to COVID last year, I didn't get to play at all, but this year it has been so much fun to try and get back into everything. Also this year, I convinced my dad to set up our pool early. I created and written a whole paragraph, and I finally convinced him to set it up instead of June 1st, we set it up May 24th. Also, during the summer, I'm really looking forward to seeing my cousins and going to our family lake. I always enjoy seeing my cousins so much because they're so friendly, welcoming, and I really like them. One of my favorite Bible verses was taught to me by one of my favorite camp counselors, Johnny C.K. He taught it to me about 2 years ago, and it always has stuck with me throughout times that I feel stressed or afraid. It is Jeremiah 29:11. It goes, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plan for welfare, not for evil, to give you a future and a hope." I really like that verse, and it has helped me through many trying times. Thank you.
Well, there you have it. Thank you for taking the opportunity to to watch that and to enjoy a little snippets from my children. It's an opportunity for us just to be giving back to you because it's been such an incredible journey for us and for each one of my children to be part of a wonderful church family and the experiences that we have had and share and continue to in relationship with all of you. So our love to you. Many, many thanks. Let's jump back in and enjoy some time together and worship. And again, worship, these expressions, although we can't be together to sing and lift our hands and praise, it is an opportunity for us to prepare our hearts and to prime the pump, if you will, of what the Holy Spirit wants to say to us through the living and active Word of God in our hearts. And so I want to share with you again a song through Pacific Lake Bible College, a resource that has been available to us. And this song is called Evidence. It's been a song that's been in my mind. I think I played it the weeks before. And allow it to just, again, prime you into a place of ready receptiveness of what God has wanted to share with us today.
Throughout my history, faithfulness has walked beside me. Winter storms made way for spring. In every season, from where I'm standing, I see the evidence of your good.
I see the evidence of your good.
promises in fulfillment all over my life, all over my life.
Amen. I'm going to ask Cam to read Exodus 19, verses 9 to 13. Go ahead, Cam.
And the Lord said to Moses, "Behold, I am coming to you in a thick cloud, that the people may hear when I speak with you, and may also believe you forever." When Moses told the words of the people to the Lord said to Moses, "Go to the people and consecrate them, and tomorrow, and let them wash their garments, and be ready for the third day. For on the third day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people, and you shall set limits for all the people around, saying, 'Take care not to go up into the mountain or touch the edge of it. Whoever touches the mountain shall be put to death. No hand shall touch him, but he shall be stoned or shot. Whether beast or man, he shall not live. When the trumpet sounds a long blast, they shall come up to the mountain.'"
Thank you, Cam. You see this gathering of 2 million people and this consecration effort that is given as a mandate from the Lord, to the point where they're not even to touch the mountain where God is residing. And we're going to be unpacking a little bit of that in the next little bit. Before we do that, I want to take the opportunity to pause and pray, and to pray for one another and pray and care into our community. I know there are many, many needs, and I just want to open that up. If there is any particular need that you'd want to be prayed for right now, as that you would like to make aware to our church family, by all means, I want to open that up to you. If anybody cares to share what is going on, maybe it's a celebration point, maybe it's a challenge. I'm not sure, but by all means, we want to pray into that as well. So I'll just open it up. If anybody wants to share, you can just take yourself off mute and speak.
I got a text from my next door neighbor today. She's in her, probably in her mid to late 30s, and her mother died yesterday. And she texted me because she knew I'd lost my father about a year ago. She was just wondering if it gets better. So if we could just pray for her. Her name is Amber.
Amber, okay. Thanks, Pamela, for sharing. Good to see you this morning. All right, let's pray. You join me, and I know there's probably other things that may come to mind as we pray and ask God to orchestrate certain things according to his plan, that he would give us the patience to be willing to wait upon the Lord in these times as well, and to work through all the aspects of what he's building into our character. So Jesus, we pause right now, and we thank you for this day that's set aside to worship you. God, I want to give you praise and thanks for this family, this church family that we have, the care and delight that we have in one another. And when one person rejoices, we all rejoice. And when one person has sorrow, we join them in that as well. And so, Father, you know the human experience because of Jesus. And we thank you that you chose to not stay up on the mountaintop, but you descended and you tabernacled, you dwelt amongst us and related to us. And so we're grateful that we now can approach you with our concerns, our cares, and our praises and our thanksgiving. And so we praise you this morning for what you're doing in everyone's life, that Father, that there's a plan and a purpose for your people, and you've not left us here alone. And so we pray into this concern that of this neighbor of Pamela, her name is Amber, Lord, you know her and the loss that she is suffering. And Lord, in your comfort and your care, would you bring about certain circumstances and relational intersections that will help her to process and deal with the pain. And if Father, if she's not a follower, no knowledge of who you are, Jesus, I pray you'd reveal and prepare her heart to hear the heart of her heavenly Father and your calling to her in this time. Would you instruct and give wisdom to Pamela to know how to speak to her and to care for her as a sister? And so, Lord, I pray these things. Lord, we know the summer is coming upon us. We know the anticipation, hope that we have for gathering in the next few weeks. And so we pray. Oh, God, we commit ourselves in the timeline that you have. And we ask, oh, Lord, that you would bring a deep sense of hope and joy into our communities this month. And Lord, I pray where there is unhealth due to physical concerns or unhealth due to poor choices, Lord, I pray grace into those circumstances and situations. I pray that there would be a sense and deep sense of understanding of what repentance means in particular areas as well. And that you would draw us into your kindness that leads to repentance. And so, Father, I pray that upon our people. Lord, you're the great shepherd of the sheep. You do not leave us by ourselves, but you tend and care for us, and you lead us into still, quiet waters, and you restore our souls. And so, Lord, I pray for restoration this morning as we encounter you, and we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue the narrative in Exodus 19. Jerry, if you've got Exodus 19 before you, if you could unmute yourself there and read verses 16 to 20.
Then it came to pass on the third day in the morning that there were thunderings and lightnings and a thick cloud on the mountain, and the sound of the trumpet was very loud. All the people who were in the camp trembled. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded long and became louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered them by voice. Then the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mountain, and the Lord called Moses to the top of the mountain, and Moses went up.
Awesome. Thank you. I don't know if you've watched the great narrative of the 1960s, the crossing of the Red Sea, and I can't remember the name of the actor, but it has this idea of Moses going up to the mountaintop at Mount Sinai. He receives the great 10 commandments of Exodus 20, which we'll look at a bit next week, and he comes back down, he delivers the message of the commandments. If you study this passage of scripture, Moses ascended the mountain, not once, not twice, not three times, but he went up and down seven times to meet with the Lord and bring messages back down to the people. Now think about that. That's, I'm not sure how high he climbed, but given that mountain is the better part of 8,000 feet high, you can tell that Moses was in pretty good shape. And so keep that in mind, that he went up and down. And this was a very important event of the people of Israel. It's recorded, and they return to this often when God called them as their own people, and they consecrated themselves. Thank you, Jerry, for sharing that. In chapter 19, again, the rest of this passage says this: then the Lord told Moses, go back down. So again, he's gone up, gone back down, as Jerry and Cam have just read, and warned the people not to break through the boundaries to see the Lord, or they will die. Even the priests who regularly come near to the Lord must purify themselves so the Lord does not break out and destroy them. And you see this really strong exhortation from the Lord. But Lord, Moses protested, the people cannot come up to Mount Sinai. You already warned us. You told me, mark off a boundary all around the mountain to set it apart as holy. But the Lord said, go down, bring Aaron back up with you. And in the meantime, do not let the priests or the people break through to approach the Lord, or he will break out and destroy them. And so again, a very stark line that God is making there. So Moses went down to the people and told them what the Lord had said. And there, may God add to his word. And let's jump into a bit of a teaching this morning around this incredible event when God met up with his people. Now, I don't know about you, but have you ever had a mountaintop experience with God? And it's a familiar expression that probably comes from the fact that many godly individuals in the Bible had significant experiences with God on a mountain. I mean, you think about some of those, God gave his covenant to Noah on Mount Ararat after the ark came and settled in after the flood. I mean, you think about God providing the ram for Abraham when as a substitute for Isaac on Mount Moriah. And of course, the classic battle of Elijah and when he defeated the prophets of Baal on Mount Carmel. And then fast forward to the New Testament. I mean, these great experiences of even Jesus himself being transfigured on a mountain. And our text today has this amazing meeting with God on Mount Sinai. And so I want to ask you a question this morning in light of the passage of Scripture. And that is, can you name the most important priority in your life? What is number one? Or let me ask you this. What is the single most important investment you will ever make for your days on earth? Exodus 19 here helps to stimulate some thoughts around life's most important priorities. And I can't help but think, as I've been reading through this passage of Scripture, that this particular mountaintop experience can teach us about our own meeting with God. And it needs to be priority one. And so here in the backdrop, in the shadow of Mount Sinai, is where these Hebrews encountered their God. And they had to be properly prepared for that. And the mountain, as I mentioned, is this majestic mountain, and 2 million people strong at its base, gazing up at this 8,000-foot gigantic, it literally looks like a gigantic fist, and it's a place God had planned to meet his people. God orchestrated that, and it's a place where he claimed his people as his own, but they had to be prepared. They had to be ready to receive the revelation that God was going to bring to them. And so right out of the gates, I want to share with you this list, I would say, of four requirements that God laid out before he brought his revelation to them. And first and foremost, and if you're taking notes, you can do this really quickly. I'm not going to jump back and forth to screen share. We've done enough of that this morning, so I got to just let you listen. But first of all, I think it's really clear in this passage of Scripture that God's first requirement is let's be willing. You need to be willing to obey. Willing to obey. Again, in verse 5, it says this. It says, "Now if you will obey me and you keep my covenant, you will be my special treasure from amongst the people." And so God wanted to be sure that his words didn't fall on deaf ears. And so there was a requirement that he had Moses say and get and for the people to display to answer back a willingness. And they did just that. He gathers the elders together and he asks them if they're willing to obey. And the response is 2 million strong. Yes, Lord, we will obey what it is you say. And so then Moses then goes back up and he climbs up the mountain again. And then I think the second thing is not just really willing to obey, but be sensitive to listen. Again, verse 9, then the Lord said, "I will come to you in a thick cloud, Moses, so the people themselves can hear me when I speak with you, then they will always trust you." And so there's this idea of being willing to obey and be sensitive when God is speaking, to hear it. And God is laying down the ground rules for communication. We need that, right? In order for anyone to communicate, you got to be willing to stop and listen to what they're saying. And so that this way, if they're willing to do that, he can tell them, God can then reveal the truths of what he wants to bring to them when they are willing to hear and when they're willing to obey. And if that is ready and our hearts are ready, and you can step into the next aspect and requirement, that is this idea of consecrating your hearts. Cam read this beautifully. And again, in verse 14, just to highlight it. So Moses went down to the people and he consecrated them for worship, and they washed their clothes. This whole idea of setting aside both inside and outside, their clean garments were a representative of their clean hearts. And there, in essence, no soil was to dirty their very souls. And so they were to be clean and pure within and without. And then he states to them, and I find this amazing, in verse 12 to 13, that was read here, put up a fence. Put up a barrier around the people so the people will not wander too close. This whole idea of, hey, consecrate yourselves. You're about to encounter the holy God. A holy God who in essence is unapproachable. And yet God is starting to break down the boundaries and reveal himself to his people for the first time in a very special way. And so there's obedience, there's listening, and then there's this consecration. And fourthly, to show a deep respect for God's presence. And so the people, again, were instructed and they were prepared for God's revelation. And so deep and so profound must be the respect for God's holy presence that no one was even to touch the mountain. And the people were to wait upon God to speak through his servant Moses and to hear what the Lord's word would be through Moses. So I leave those four with you because it's a great reminder, particularly this whole idea of showing respect for God's presence. And I was really convicted as I was reading through this, because we often live our days, in a pitiful concept of who God is. I'm not sure what your portrayal of God is, but obviously in light of the New Testament and the New Covenant with Jesus, it transforms and changes that. But at the same time, I don't think we need to cheapen and degrade the holiness of God. See, what I love about this chapter is that it reminds us of this elevated, exalted position of who God is. And that we are not to approach God just haphazardly or frivolously in his presence. I've heard some teachers lament this idea of how we reduce God to the idea of, you know, my pal status, or that he's my understanding buddy, and that he's grace all for sure, but he's also God. And I don't want to demean or take away from the presence of God's Spirit, which is the Spirit of Christ, which he's like a brother and he sticks close to us. He is our understanding friend. But remember also, the Lord is God. And the fact that when we approach God, we don't do it in this hurried pace, because God doesn't bow to our hurried pace. But in silence, he waits for us to meet his standard and his requirements. And what I find amazing about that is, miraculously, once we do that, God has got this incredible way of downloading some spiritual depth to us in our lives. And so I have to ask myself the question, and I return the question to you. What is your concept of the Lord? How do you view God? Does he look like the God of Mount Sinai here? Just sit on that for a bit. And so there's a meeting and an encounter that the people experience after making themselves ready. In chapter 19, again, 16 and 19, it has this imagery of Jerry read of the third day, the thunder roaring, the lightning flashes, this dense cloud, there's this incredible blast of horns. And Moses is led out from the camp to meet with God, and they stand at the foot of this mountain. And the Lord descends on it in the form of fire. It must have been incredibly frightening for the people. And I have to ask myself a question. Any expositor, as you're studying the word of God, use the simple questions: who, what, when, where, and why. No, why this meeting? why this encounter? What is Jehovah God doing in light of calling his people to himself? Why this particular meeting and why this way? Well, I think the text gives us two very good reasons why this happens. In the next chapter, chapter 20, the famous chapter, the Ten Commandments, in the end of, after God delivers the Ten Commandments and Moses relays it to them, Moses actually says to the people in answer to this question, why the meeting? It was to establish a healthy fear of God Almighty. And I say healthy, not a unhealthy fear, but a healthy fear. And let me talk to you about that, because I think it's really important. This is what 20:20 says. Moses writes in Exodus 20. Moses said to the people, do not be afraid. So you can imagine what's just taking place here. There's probably fear. There's trembling. There's concern. Don't touch the mountain. There's a gate. There's all this kind of stuff. There's fire and all the what's going on, and the thunder and roaring and trumpet blast. Moses says, don't be afraid. For God has come in order to what? Test you. And in order that and understand this, in order that the fear of God, fear of him, remains with you, so that you may not sin. So why the meeting? To establish a healthy fear of the Almighty. Moses said to the people again, don't be afraid. So healthy fear of God will do much to deter us from sin, right? And that's the reason. God wanted to establish himself in his holy presence to say, you know what? I love you. You're my special people. You're my possession. If you understand who I am, my character, and you have a healthy fear of who I am, it will keep you away from blatant sin. And so when we have a proper fear of the Lord, we actually live a cleaner life. And so and this is a profound thing I was thinking about, because any person that's been born again, who's received Christ and we're born from above, who actually sins willfully, has to actually momentarily block out the fear of God. You know what? You and I do that. Because when we sin, we actually consciously put aside what we know to be the truth about God, and we lie to ourselves. You know, saying things like, well, God won't mind that much. I can do what I please, and then I'll bring my sacrifice of forgiveness later. And I've been there. I've fallen into that trap. We all have. And it's a great reminder that it's dangerous ground for the believer to run into those kind of mindset. Because here's the truth. You can live as you please if you know that you're not being seen and you won't get caught. But if deep down inside, you know that there's a living, a holy God who will not let you get away with sin, you will work to avoid sin at all costs. Because a holy God and a sinful man, we know, doesn't match. That's why Jesus came. And so, yes, we're set apart as believers, but we got to watch ourselves and keep short accounts. And I love this passage of scripture because, again, it shares this stark contrast between a holy God and man and humans. And so God does that to set up a healthy fear. And he does it for our own good. He says, don't be fearful. Allow my holiness and who I am to drive you into your understanding of who I am, so that I can deposit even greater holiness into you. And so second thing I think here is why this encounter. And that was simply God wanted to communicate written instructions for his people. So Moses is called up again with Joshua later on in chapter 24. So this whole aspect of the book of Exodus, if I can just recap for you, chapters 1-18 deal with the whole getting the people out of Egypt into the wilderness and get them to be set apart. And then today in chapters 19 through verse 25, chapters 25 is all about the instruction of the law. And then the last part of the book of Exodus from 26 to 40 is all about God communicating his instructions around his tabernacle, the place where he will dwell. So just a little snippet so you understand the three partitions of the book of Exodus. So The second reason is to communicate these written instructions for his people. And so Moses and Joshua in chapter 24, later on, you can read it later, are given the, you know, the classic stone tablets with the law and the commandments. And when I think about this, it's pretty cool that God would actually write things down. And we have them today. Think about that. It's an awesome thought. And what a privilege that we take maybe all too often for granted that God has given us his written word for us. Before the collapse of a very atheistic Soviet Union, a fellow by the name of John Van Diest represented the Evangelical Christian Publishers Association, and they were at a Moscow book fair. And the authorities there actually reluctantly granted them permission to hand out a limited number of Russian language New Testaments. And there was a long line, it was an incredible long lines of people waiting to receive a copy of the scriptures. And when the supplies were done, when they were exhausted, one desperate man, he relates the story, was deeply disappointed that he asked them, he couldn't receive a New Testament, there was no more, but he asked them if he could have one of the empty boxes that had held the New Testaments. And John said to him, but there's nothing here. The Bibles are gone. And you can imagine this man with tears glistening in his eyes. He says, then at least I want the box. And I relay that story because I think we forget how precious we have in this treasure of the Bible. And so much so, this man just wanted the cardboard box that held the Holy Scriptures. And may our eyes be open to the incredible privilege that is ours to actually hold the complete Word of God in our hands. And so God gave them the written Word. And it says he revealed in the latter parts of this wonderful book, the tabernacle. And it does so, I've read through it, and if you get an opportunity to read through the rest of Exodus, because we're not going to be able to get through it all before we get to summer, but with great detail, God lays out the plans for their place of worship. And so God gave him his deep respect for his very name, the Lord God, and he gives them the word of God so that they might know his mind and obey. And he gives them this design for the tabernacle that he might come down and actually live amongst them. And John actually records this because it's a foreshadow in John chapter 1 that talks about the living word, the Logos, Christ Jesus himself, who came down, and the actual Greek word is, and tabernacled amongst us. That God actually came to dwell with us. He wanted to make himself accessible and available in a certain place for the people of Israel, and of course, in our very hearts. Now God tabernacles with us today. And so in application, this encounter with God, I see in these verses that would suggest that the number one priority for you and I that will determine more than anything else in our ability to live a life of victory is actually meeting with God regularly. Meeting with God regularly. Because you know, you've probably come through a wilderness experience. You've been brought through baptism of the Red Sea, and perhaps you've never come to that mountain experience, to that place where we consistently and regularly have our time with him. And I believe this encounter with God suggests just a few principles, and quickly I'll get through this. I know the hour is getting late, but you can bear with me. That Moses, this encounter with God suggests a few principles that I want to take with you, and that's really quickly here. Number one, to meet regularly with God, you need a place. Verse 1 of chapter 19, it says just that. The first thing that's mentioned is that God brought them to a particular geographical location, a place where they met with him. And the question is, do you have that place? Beside me is actually my lazy boy chair. And up on the side is a lamp. And under that lamp lies my Bible and my journal. And it's a place that I look and work hard to try to regularly meet with God. Well, sometimes I work hard, but it's my place. It's a place where I know I can meet, and I've got my pen there, and it should have come equipped with just that. And I ask yourself, you know, where's your place to meet regularly with God? It could be, you know, your kitchen table. It could be your backyard in a, you know, wherever that intentional place is. Find it. So meet regularly with God. You need a place. Secondly, you need to be prepared. I see this in this passage of scripture. Their hearts need to be prepared. You can't just walk into the presence of God with a ho-hum kind of attitude. I was always instructed as an opportunity through some friends and mentors in my life. When you come into worship in the sanctuary of God, pause. Take an opportunity to pray and just quiet your hearts. I mean, all too often we enter into it, you know, we've just shut off our iPhone after watching a game or something that's going on, or, you know, there's activities of the day that are still encroaching upon your mind and occupying those places and spaces of your head. And we need to slow down. We need to slow down and pause and get our heartbeat to beat with the rate that the Lord's is beating. And it's worth it. You need to be prepared. We need a place. We need to be prepared. And Jesus was very clear in John 15, talking about connecting with him. He says to his disciples, I'm the vine. Remember that. You guys are the branches, and you need to get plugged into me. And he says these very profound words, and that is this. Because apart from me, this is Jesus, you can do nothing. You can do nothing. That kind of strikes me and hits me between the eyes. We can work hard at all sorts of things, hoping that we're doing kingdom work or whatever we're doing. And Christ is saying, you know what? Until you connect with me, until you prepare your hearts, until you slow down enough, until you get into that place, you're going to miss what I have for you. And where we get that from is thirdly, you need the scriptures. You need the scriptures. I mean, God gave his people his book to read the book. And you meet with God, you open his book, and Moses was told to take the written truths, and then he actually says to instruct the people. And so open the book. Take a book of the scriptures, walk through it. I've been enjoying I started my last this year in Genesis, and I've just been reading through because I wanted to get through Exodus. And now I'm reading through, you know, Judges into Ruth and to now in 1 Samuel. And just to, not just to plow through it, but to take the opportunity to slow down and allow the scripture to pop out at you. All too often we go to devotional books, which are great, but they don't feed us the way the scripture can. Or God brings about certain things from the scriptures that are pertinent to you right now today. I had that experience this very morning, a fairly unique passage of scripture. And I loved it, what God was saying to me. It would mean nothing to nobody else, but for me, it was very profound. We need the scriptures. And so let this be a reminder to you, my friends, that we need to meet regularly with God. And it will have a major, and I believe a recognizable impact on how your attitude is through the day, your relationship with your spouse or friends or relationships, your career, the very words of your tongue, and of course, your diligence in day-to-day activities. So you need a place. You need to be prepared. You need to be in the scriptures. And fourthly, and I know you're all saying this, I've heard this before. Well, part of our issue is not knowing, it's doing, right? And lastly, one of the things I've struggled with and tried not to do much of my Christian career, and that is, remember to write down what God is saying to you. I'm not a journaler by nature, but I'm forcing myself to do that. Write it down. I know some of you are really good about that. Some of you have books and books on your shelf, and I know who you are, and I applaud you for that, because a journal is able to record, as Webster says, it's the current transactions, experiences, ideas, and reflections for your personal use, not for anyone else. These writings are for you to maintain your memory of what God is doing. Remember that. So you need a place. You need to be prepared. You need to be into the scriptures. And I'm saying need, you need to. And you need to be writing things down. And my friends, a deeper, more consistent walk with Christ requires time and attention every day. And if that happens, the promise is out of John 15 that Jesus says, you will bear fruit. You will bear fruit. You will see that in your life and relationships with others. And you will experience, I trust, you know, struggles that you'll walk with God, but fewer struggles because your attitude is correct. And your sharing your faith will come a lot easier. And hangups and hookups that you've had in the past that tend to trip you tend to free up. You respond to authority and you can hear God's will for you. Those are some of the fruits of regularly connecting with God. And that is why, when I asked you the question at the beginning of this message, your number one priority needs to be meeting with God. And so I'm going to challenge you, friends, make this a summer to keep a regular appointment with God. It takes discipline for sure. It takes preparation. But it's one thing to know what it is to do. It's another thing to do it, right? But know this. God is waiting there, and all he wants is you. That's something to build your life upon. Amen? And amen. And so, God, we just pray you would fall fresh upon us in this week, renewing our minds to hear from you and to establish your good work in our hearts. And so apart from all those distractions and things that tend to drag us away, we pray, Father, that you would draw us back into that place. For the promise of James, where you say, draw close to God. If you draw close to me, the promise is I will draw close to you. And you don't forget your promises. And so I pray that we would live this out and experience this in Christ's name. Amen. trust you have been moved towards the heart of God with a deep awe and respect of who he is, and that it is an opportunity each day to have an encounter with him. Very clear in scripture where it says his mercies are new every morning, and there's no guilt or shame that we need to hold on to because of Christ. And we greet each morning saying, oh, this is a new day for me to experience who God is and the hope that comes with that. And so I leave you now with a benediction, and thank you so much for being a part of our time and opportunity this morning. We will have a breakout rooms. Love to meet with you if you care to join myself and others. It'd be awesome. And just stay in and say yes to the prompting. But I want to leave you from Romans 15, verse 13, just the thoughts before you leave. And before I do that, just another reminder. We got quite a few activities. Again, Zoom next week, grads and dads. Looking forward to that. And, of course, our barbecue in the backyard on June 27th. I'd love to see you all that is there. But receive the benediction now. Out of Romans 15, I pray that that God, the source of hope, will fill you completely with joy and peace because you trust in him. Then you will overflow with confident hope through the power of the Holy Spirit. God bless you. Have a spectacular week, my friends.